That's Pam working the back. We've had some really fantastic volunteers tonight that have made my life tremendously easier, and we'll thank them at the end. And thank you to Impact Hub for hosting us. It's awesome. Round of applause again. It's 2017. I sometimes do like a recap of last year, and I'm just too busy to get through it. But we had a really great year last year, and I'm expecting an even better year this year. It's off to a really good start, as you can see. So I'm going to see if our sponsors want to say a quick word. Yeah? Okay.
Always.
One and then two. Hello.
Hi, I'm Philip Kaplan. I run DistroKid. Does anybody know DistroKid?
Cool.
A service that makes it really easy for musicians to get their music into Spotify and iTunes and Google Play and all the places. And Apple, we're being videoed, right? And Amazon and Tidal and Deezer and iMusica and Pandora. It's $20 a year. You can upload unlimited music. You can do cover song licensing. We have a way to automatically pay all of the, you know, if you have collaborators or whatever, really easy. Anyway, very proud to be a sponsor of Seth and this awesome, I'm not a sponsor of Seth at all, but sponsor of Seth's meetup.
Hey, I'm Dimitri Visa with Rock, Paper, Scissors. You may have seen these postcards around. That's my company. We're a PR company that focuses on music technology companies. So we work with companies like CD Baby, Lyric Find, Gig Salad, and a bunch more you can read about on the postcard. We're also involved with some other meetups in Chicago. 2112 is an incubator that does a lot of music tech meetups. If you're ever in Chicago, you should give me a buzz. I'll let you know what's happening there. We also work with Project Music in Nashville, which is an accelerator program that you should check out if you're looking to kind of get trained up on the music business and also opportunities to meet investors and so forth. So, and we'll do a music tech meetup at South by Southwest as well. So hit me up if you're interested in finding out about that. So be glad to meet you all, and thanks for being here.
All right. Thanks, Dimitri and Philip.
We have a little drawing tonight as well. If you put your business card in this little black bin here, we're going to draw one at the end of the night and give a free one-hour PR consultation to the winner. So we can pass this around and put your business card. If you don't have a card, you can just put your email address in there. So I'll circulate this.
Thanks. Best I have. All right, cool. So this is a music tech meetup, and it actually took me a number of years to realize that we needed to have more music. And so I'm just going to introduce our artist for tonight. It's Darren Solomon, and he's going to play something for us.
Thanks. I'll actually talk a little bit about what I'm going to do. If I get a word about it, I'm talking to you again. Thanks for having me, Seth. Fun, awesome. My day gig is music for TV commercials as a composer, and when I get to my own stuff, I like to do electronic music mostly. I like to mix it with old samples or acoustic stuff and experiment with that. I teach composition at SUNY Purchase one day a week. And I also do music for dance, so I do all kinds of different stuff. This set that I'm going to do for you now, I'm going to do a short version of it, is my attempt to kind of bring a lot of the world's music into one key in a way that I can improvise with it. So I brought everything in the key B flat, C minor, and it's a lot of work, many, many months, to get everything into Ableton and loaded right. And so I have, for example, this is Astrid Gilberto, the Brazilian singer. And so I can kind of play with that and loop that and do fun stuff with that. This is Charles Ives, The Unanswered Question, just the string part. So I can bring that in there, and I've got... This is Justin Bieber, Slow Down 800%. And I can mix that with, this is Kanye West, also Slow Down 800%. And I could lay on top of that, let's say, a scene from Dr. Strangelove. So it's a lot of fun. It lets me just improvise with this stuff and make music on the fly. Of all the places I've done this, the most satisfying was Burning Man, where people like prayed and had sex and all kinds of fun stuff like while I was doing it, which is the best reaction ever as a musician. So yeah, I'm just gonna improvise. I don't really know what's gonna happen. I've got stuff from recordings from the American South in the 30s. I've got classical music, I've got jazz.
See what happens. All right. Thanks, Sam. So,
okay, that just brought my pulse down. Like, that's good. I did sound meditation recently for the first time, and it just kind of had a transformative effect on me. Like, that felt very meditative. So, I hope you'll play a little bit more afterwards.
It'll be more upbeat.
Okay. And let's get things going. Our first demo tonight is Claire demoing her company called LessonFace, and then I'm just going to hand you the mic and take it away. Plug you in.
My co-founder, Asher Tucker, is also here, and our community manager, Kelly Lepperman. Thanks for having us. So LessonFace is a site that connects music teachers with dedicated music students all over the world. We've been live for about 4 years now. We have about 10,000 registrants, about 350 teachers, and they cover about 85 instruments. Our students are all over the world. We do one-on-one lessons and group classes all over video conference. So you can see kind of the basic interface in the video up top. And it's basically a marketplace site. So teachers create their profiles, they set their rates, they set their schedules, and create their profile pages, and then students can come in and basically filter by whatever it is that they care about. And I was hoping I was going to be able to demonstrate tonight. We're adding genre as one of the filters, but it's not quite ready to roll out yet. And then we vet all the teachers who create the profiles to make sure that they fit our qualifications for expertise. And then the students can find the person, they can go to their profile page, they can book a lesson. And I'm already logged in as a user. So they can choose and go through and create a lesson. So this is Rod Ferreira, whose page I'm on, and I actually have a lesson set up with him already. So I'm just going to go to my dashboard so you can skip that checkout part. This is the student dashboard page. The student side is pretty basic, the teacher side is a little bit more involved on the back end, but with the students, we've kept it pretty simple. So you have your lessons here, and this is a test account. You can see that I've been sending some test messages back and forth. And then you can favorite teachers on the platform as a student, and then you can come through and like see who your favorite teachers are. Okay, so here are the lessons that I have set up currently, and then you can just join. So we've incorporated this video conference system called Video. Hey, Rod. So Rod is in Chicago. I'll spin you around so you can see the room. cool. Yeah, so did you have something you wanted to demonstrate briefly? Let me see if I can turn this up actually a little bit. It looks like we don't have a super strong. Oh, there we go. Cool, yeah, now we're hearing you quite well.
good. Cool.
Yeah, that sounds great. Yeah, I can see we're getting a little warning signal. I think the Wi-Fi is not terribly strong in here. But yeah, we are seeing you and hearing you well.
Okay, good. I can hear and see that's perfectly. So you just guys have to endure with some of my problems there.
No, it looks great. Cool. Well, yeah, would you mind just saying something about how you find online lessons to be, like how it works versus in-person
right,
lessons?
Right, absolutely. Yeah, you know, I've been teaching for the past, like, you know, 10, 15 years, and the online thing is just great for me. I prefer doing the online thing. I have no problem with, you know, parking or travel to a place to teach, so that saves me a lot of time, you know. I don't have to stop a lesson to give students direction to, you know, to the place, because everything is online. So it allows me to schedule back-to-back lessons, which is, you know, great for me because I don't have that 10, 15 minutes, which at the end of the day, you know, it becomes a solid hour of not working, which is great for me to schedule back-to-back lessons. Another great thing for me is that, you know, you guys can't see, but I have all my gear around me. So if I need a different guitar or a different pedal or a different amp, you know, it's right within my reach, so I don't have to travel with three guitars, you know, two amps, a bunch of books, you know. The online lessons really allows me to send files to students too. So if someone needs a different song or review on some scales or some stuff like that, you know, it's just one click away. I don't need to make notes and then come back home and email people. So that definitely helps a lot too. You know, another really cool thing that LessonFace allows us teachers to do is to get the students' information prior to lesson. So that's great because then I can connect with the student, you know, before the lesson, make sure they understand what they want to learn, you know, make sure that I can give them a little bit of instructions about make sure that your camera is on the guitar, not just on your face, right?
Right.
Do a little reminder to students to make sure that even though they're home, they should wear a shirt. Sometimes people tend to get a little bit too comfortable. That's always like good to have all those things. So in my experience, honestly, like I think for the past 5 years that the online lessons have become more and more popular, you know, for me as a teacher and for students too. You know, every student that I ever had that tried it online once, they never want to try anywhere anymore.
Cool. Yeah, that's awesome. Thanks so much, Ryan. That's the basic demo. Does anybody have questions for me or Rod? Sure.
One question is, I know YZAMs, which I've used for tutoring other things like math and charges, the first fee that they take is 40% of what you charge, and I was wondering what your fee is. It must be less than that.
It is, yeah. Our fee is a flat 15%.
Nice. And how do you measure, is it by user rating? I'm sure that too, but how do you measure the teachers? How good they are and or whether you want them there at all as teachers?
We have basic qualifications that teachers have to meet in order to be listed on this site. They can fit in one or of two or in both buckets. They can be a professional musician with that as their main source of income for at least 5 years. We do have a lot of performing artists, you know, that are doing it on tour. Or they can be a teacher who has been teaching for at least 2 years. We run background checks on the teachers, and then we do collect ratings from students. So we have the vetting up front, and then we also just make sure that people are enjoying the lessons, and we measure retention based on each teacher. So we have a really, really excellent teacher roster. Did you have?
Can you play with a student? Does that work well together as a teacher?
It depends on.
Yeah.
Yeah, it depends on the connection. So sometimes you can and sometimes you cannot. Sometimes you have to do kind of a call and response. Did you hear that question, Brad?
Can you repeat that for me, please?
Can you play in time with the student?
Oh yeah, absolutely, absolutely. You know, like I've never had any issues with people having internet that the connection would get in the way. Quite oftentimes, I even seen the drum loop. So there's actually three tracks being played: me, the student, and the drum loop.
Cool. That's good to hear.
For the students, is it a subscription basis? Like, could I take a class on a ukulele and then a class on a clarinet? Or is there a commitment that you need to?
So the teachers set their own rates, and they set them based on the lesson duration. And then they can also choose if they want to offer bundles for lessons. So students can come in and they can book a lesson at a time. Or they can book 20 lessons at a time, and then they usually get some sort of break based on what the teacher wants to do. It's not, strictly speaking, a subscription. No. Yeah, so yeah, you're kind of paying as you go in most cases. Yeah.
How did you get into the business? Are you a teacher or a student or a musician?
I am an ed tech person. So prior to this, I was marketing officer and chief product development officer for a different ed tech startup that was in green education, green jobs training. And my co-founder actually had the idea of doing this for music based on a conversation with a friend who was getting requests for Skype lessons. And in the conversation, he said, well, you know, you can get a bunch of performers together and offer Skype lessons together. And the teacher said, yeah, it's a great idea, but I am performing and I'm not gonna do it. So anyway, Asher told me about it, and it just really gelled with things that I was seeing in my job, where I was creating like these self-paced courses for training, but we were seeing students really wanted live interaction. Like, they want to be face-to-face with the teacher, and they want that accountability and the schedule and to show up when it's something really hard that you're having to learn, like music. That, you know, it takes a lot of work to get good at. Having that mentor is a huge help. And finding the exact right person, you know, without geographic bounds really helps you hone in on the right inspiring mentor. Sure.
Yeah, I wanted to ask, how is your, like, international traffic, like, for teachers and students?
About 85% of our students are based in the US, and another like 7% are Canadian. So we're very North American centric. But we do get people from all over the world. The site currently isn't localized to other currencies. So we haven't like deliberately gone out there and marketed. But yeah, you know, we get Australians and Asians and people dialing in from everywhere. And then we do have international teachers also, although I would say that the US-based teachers are largely more successful for like the same reasons I would expect. Yeah. It is something, yeah, I would love to expand more as we continue to grow.
Maybe two more questions on that.
Okay.
On a similar note, do you see a lot of adults picking up instruments for the first time, or is the majority of the user base younger kids?
Yeah, we're about half and half, adults and kids. Our first adopters were more adults, and we've had to be more deliberate about designing the site so that parents and kids were using it. And so, yeah, now we do have a lot of kid users as well. And people will pick up an instrument for the first time and they'll come back to it. You know, it seems really common that somebody, you know, took band back in high school, and then now they, you know, they want to get back into it. And so you don't have to travel, and it's easy.
What are some of the challenges that are kind of ahead of you? What are some of the goals for the company going forward?
Well, yeah, so we want to continue to grow, of course, find more great students and teachers as we continue to build the product. The site works well, but there are definitely features that we're aiming to add, allowing people to add more notes to the lessons. You can send messages on the platform currently, but you can't add them to specific lessons, and having like a really good record of, you know, your lessons as you go through them, I think would be really useful for students. But yeah. That's it. Okay. Thank you so much. Thanks so much, Brad.
Claire, that was great. And you guys are totally self-sufficient at this point. Like you're at a place now where you can kind of grow and scale. And I would love for you to come back again next year, so we can kind of see how things evolve.
That sounds good.
Okay, cool. So, do you need a sec to set up, or how are you feeling, Sam? Okay, great. Yeah, so let's just keep the ball rolling. Next up, we have Sam Z. We have two Sams tonight. And I'm just gonna pass you the mic. Sam is with Audio Fusion.
Great. How are you guys all doing tonight? Thanks for coming out. It's really great to be here and to connect with the community. This is one of our first major New York Music Tech Meetups, so it's a real honor to be here with you guys and to share my project. So, not long ago, it was about 3 years now, I was a student in university, learning about recording studio technology, really what's behind a lot of the great music that we listen to today, and the classics were these recording studio suites that were really hard to reach up until now. So, really, when I was a student, I was frustrated by the lack of access that I had to recording studios, so I started simulating them into a software, and really not sure where it would take me, just step by step, it just kept really having a value, whether it was really reproducing the steps that I was facing in the studio so that I could actually operate some of the gear, to where we are now, where we have a startup and we're actually trying to help other institutions teach this stuff, and also for other educators who have not previously been able to teach this technology because of how hard it is to access. Now we could actually have the software that works with us. So it started out in a 2D environment, went to 3D, and now we have virtual reality, which, by show of hands, how many of you guys are familiar with virtual reality? Good. Every single time that number grows, and that really excites me because this technology is great. So I'm just going to play a quick demo video for you, and then I'm going to just jump in the headset so you guys can really see what this thing is all about. Sound, it's gonna come out of the TV, I think.
I lost it.
It's from the TV.
Oh,
the
mic's on the TV. Oh, yeah, it's.
It's just music, so visual. It's more music.
Visual.
So, get out of that. Oh no, just kidding. Okay, great. So this is actually the view I wanted to wind up in. So that was just a teaser video we haven't released yet, just showing you that you put on a headset and you ultimately wind up in this space. So if you guys can bear with me, I'm gonna step over here on the right side. Everybody here, if you guys can try to remain seated, so if anybody over here tries to see, I'm just gonna step over here. So there's a roll off.
Cool. Do you need a microphone?
Yeah, if you could have it, that's great. Yeah, we're full screen. So I'm using. Can you guys hear me good? Like this?
Yeah, sure.
Yeah, we're good. Well, until I set up. So we're using a headset called the HTC Vive. There's a couple of different categories of VR right now. We've got some mobile VR, which is what you see with the cell phones.
then you have a headset that actually works with two hand controllers and also has two sensors that are on two corners of the room.
Cool, I'm just gonna restate what I said. So there's a difference between the mobile VR and the high-end VR that's coming out these days. The mobile is really great. You have, everybody's got a VR device in their pocket right now, potentially. You can see on the table here, there's a little cardboard box. You put your phone in there, there are two lenses, you can see into any world on your phone. With this, the high-end VR, you have a headset, controllers, and sensors that actually track where the headset and controllers are in 3D space. So I'm not actually going to see this microphone in VR in a second, but I'll try to talk into it. I'm not going to be able to talk into that. So, see, is it showing up over there on the screen?
Yeah.
Cool, so you guys can actually see exactly what I'm seeing right now.
I'm going to call if you don't mind.
All right, so this empty space here is actually one of the recording studios that I was messing around with. Okay, where you at, right here? Cool. We actually have solutions for that, by the way. With this headset system, you could put a tracking device on the microphone and see it in VR, which is something we'll be working on. But right now you can see I'm inside a recording studio, and in a second I'm just going to start engaging. And really, the last time I was able to mess around with this was in university 3 years ago. So I'm going to just dive right in, and we'll get some sound out here on the TV. So I'm just going to reach out. You know, we got our band playing. Those signals are plugged into microphones, going through the walls, showing up on this little funky device here called the patch bay. We'll get to know that in a second. But ultimately, we're getting the signal on the board. I'm losing just because you're
upset.
But let's see if we can hear it on the TV. Right, we can hear it on the TV a little bit. Sorry if it's not so loud. It's not going through the speakers, but we can see we got a signal on this TV for sure. So, really, for a lot of people, they have a hard time understanding how to get sound out of the board, and we kind of walked through some of the steps. So, you know, we had it highlighted a moment ago, but we can just start engaging with different aspects of the environment. I'm not going to drill you guys with the theory, but we kind of talked about it, where the sound is coming from the room into our control room. But the concept is called signal flow. The fact is, we have a signal source, and the signal is going anywhere we want it to. So I could come over here on the right side. Environment. So I really encourage you guys to try this out afterwards, whether you tried VR or not. It'd be great to get your feedback. But really, just walk your mom. So really, like, you guys should try this out. It's really awesome to really feel like you're in this space. And
sure. So for what we were really going for is really we just want to drop someone in this environment, let them understand what the recording studio is in a matter of minutes versus the amount of years it would take for someone to actually get the access to the studio. Like when I was in university, it took 12 months to get in front of that board. And just to realize it's just vertical chains of the same thing. You first see it and it's like 23,000 knobs, but really it's just one thing copied over 20 times and you just really in this space got to engage with it. It's yours. There's no time limit. Mess up. Break it. It's your field day. So that's Virtual Analog Studio VR. I'm really happy to be able to share it with you guys. I'll take questions if anybody has any. Sure, in the back. Thanks. Beyond education? Great. We're getting that all the time. Pretty much, here, I'm gonna just stop that audio. Pretty much, there are some people that want the recording studio to be mobile, and sorry, we'll just have to bear with the sound. So anyways, there are people that want to see this go beyond education, and we're not going to really just stop at education. It's just right now, the fact that there's a studio in VR has immediate use in education. It's so valuable to offer that access, but we got our eyes open on other avenues. Anybody else? So what you just saw me use was the high-end experience, the virtual reality experience with the high-end headset, but we do have a mobile edition. I couldn't get the phone working, but again, it'll work in here. It's more of a passive experience. You're looking around and seeing things. We've experimented and made it pair with an Xbox Kinect, if anybody remembers what that is. It's skeletal tracking, so we've made it work with the headset, and it's had some great results, but we just want to make sure it's actually smooth for institutions, educators, whoever uses it, that it's actually easy to set up, which right now it's a little bit messy. How do you mean? Oh, like multiplayer type thing? Right. We don't do the multiplayer yet, although that's right like near roadmap for us. Right. So right now we're just using an internal, we have an internal soundtrack that's playing. And we have a band that's represented there. The idea is that anybody should be able to see themselves being that band, motion captured. We're looking for more ways to incorporate the artists into the studio, not just from just having their music, but their actual persona, the things that they would do, the way that they move. So that's actually our solution right now, what you were looking at. We originally had the same size board. It was, let me see, I could actually, this is gonna be fun. I actually have, it might not work, so I'm just gonna hang out here for a second. But we had the same size console that originally had 24 channels with 8 times as many parameters per channel. So we just narrowed it down to 12, made everything a little bit more bloated, but as virtual reality gets better, like you'll be able to see a lot finer in there. Gloves, you'll be able to get a little bit more precision, but we've experimented with that. And you let me know what you think right now. We'd really like to know what you think. Yeah, you'll feel it when you're dragging the fader. You feel that thing fighting against you the whole time. So, anybody else? Any questions about it? Don't be shy. All right, we got a couple more right here.
How does the education part of it work? Is there a can you be in the virtual studio with an instructor or something like that?
So there are two parts of that. One of it was the multiplayer stuff that we were hearing a moment ago, where you could have two people actually in the VR space working together. There's this thing called asymmetric VR, when someone could be inside of the headset and someone could be sitting at the computer, clicking around and making buttons highlight and just really directing the student around. So we could be having a conversation, you and I, seeing somebody work and then just interrupt the session and just click on a button and they'll get that feedback. To elaborate a little bit more, what you guys really saw was just the environment as itself that we're giving to the education institutions now. We have some curriculum that we offer to them so that they could use it if they haven't had something previously, but we want to empower what they already teach. So we've kind of, this is like our studio side, and the curriculum part will roll out later. So if you wanted to do something independently and you don't have experience, besides for lesson tutorials on our website, you'd still want to have some sort of education thing going on with it.
Those CL1B distressor to the left, are those accurate?
MusicTech. I got PK2As, PK3As, fish techs.
Are you trying to model the actual?
That is something I am trying to do. Right now, it's kind of stock, I would call it, but it's very much on our, we're looking to that, and we're looking for partners that do it as well. We really want to be the platform for the other plugin developers that are already out there to be able to migrate over into this 3D domain, and we've been talking to some of the big players about how that could look, so we're very excited to see that unfold. That's our question over here.
So it sounds like you have a set list of sort of tones and things that you can now, are you potentially looking into making that customizable with on the go so we can kind of do that, or also partnering with potential artists and having them be the people that are in that providing real music and
Absolutely. So customization is definitely something we're looking at, and it's also one of those things that near roadmap. We just wanted for our demo to supply one space. It's kind of what you go when you go visit a studio, you don't have that opportunity to customize. So this is the scenario we want to drop you in. This is the environment you get to work with. Work with those limitations. You got 12 channels. There are other some secrets in there to get more channels on there. I'm not going to tell you now, but that's the point. Like, you should be able to approach that and realize that you're not limited all the time as much as you feel like. So customizations, we're really excited about. Any other questions? So I'm going to just quickly just show you one more thing. We have, our goal was to make the studio as accessible as possible. This is a little bit of the break off from VR, but we're going to be rolling this out in a couple weeks. We have a web version of the studio that is just a link away. Just go to a browser link and you're actually learning about the studio the same way you just saw me use a moment ago, but in a little bit easier to use interface. You know, just right on the screen, everything's just a click away. You know, we could just draw some cables like we did a moment ago. Just another way to just make the studio more accessible to people while you guys don't all have VR yet. So, really, thank you guys so much for having me. It was a real pleasure to present with you guys.
Thank you, Seth. Great job, Sam. Definitely want you to come back next year, too, so we can see how things have evolved. And, you know, the thought I had on the way over here, too, is just how important education is going to be with these startup, not just with music education, but education broadly, especially with, you know, the changes happening in our political environment, Betsy DeVos and all that. So, you know, you guys are really doing something great, and keep doing it. So last but not least, we have the other Sam, wherever he is. There he is. And he's going to be demoing his app OffTop. So come take it away. Everybody doing? I'm gonna play a quick video first. It's like a minute long, just to give you some context on the app, and then we'll get into the demo.
Doesn't wanna show that.
that's our little commercial that was shot. So while I'm getting QuickTime set up here for the demo, to give you a little context, off-top is a phrase used in hip-hop culture that means instantaneous. It means kind of without thought, to create without thinking too much. And that was the idea or the context behind the app. A lot of my friends are serious musicians, hobbyists, and not even musicians at all, but I'll catch them trying to be a musician at a party. And the idea was, you know, a studio is sort of reserved, in my opinion, for recording the final version of a song. It's a very serious environment to create music, but there's so much music creation happening outside the context of a studio, and there's not really a platform that's accurately capturing that, whether it's recreationally for practice or just to create reference tracks on the go. So we wanted to create a space for both serious musicians and hobbyists to capture music ideas from their phone, share them with others, and sort of store all of that in a space outside of the studio. So that's the inspiration behind OffTop there. And then I'll pull the app up for the demo. So whenever you first open the app, the most important element about OffTop is the beats. When you make a beat, you do it in the confinement of your home because it's a pretty serious process. I know there are a lot of apps that emulate beat making on the phone. We don't want to get into that business. We let producers make their beats at home, and then they submit their beats to us to be featured on the app so other artists and users on the app can collaborate over them. Currently, because we're in sort of a public beta and trying to figure out, you know, who our core user is and a couple things with product, we don't open up submissions to anybody. So we've gotten thousands and thousands of submissions, but we really only upload a few hundred of those as of right now, just so we can get an idea of what producers want to see and what's valuable to them. As far as how we categorize it, we try to come up with ways to help the users discover the type of instrumental they're looking for. One important component is that currently to find a beat, there are a lot of different channels like YouTube and SoundCloud and even platforms specifically meant for selling beats. But a lot of these don't really focus on the idea, like they're not solely focused on the idea of pushing a certain type of beat towards the artist. They have to do a lot of searching on their own. So we're trying to optimize that process for them and present it in a more organized fashion. So once you look through your beats and you find a beat you like, let's see. Sound. That's just a technical difficulty, but imagine that the beat is playing. It should be coming out of the speaker, but I think my output is messed up. So once you find a beat you like, you go into the record mode. And you have three modes that you can record in. You can freestyle, which is I just want to record without writing anything down. It's just an idea that I have off the top of my head. You can write verses and it'll store the verses for you so you can reference your written tracks down the road. And then rapid fire is sort of a fun mode that we're testing where the app will give you words to incorporate into your writing. So that way as a songwriter you have inspiration and can kind of improve your vocabulary and the process of practicing from your phone as well. And the idea here is like, you know, right when I click record, let's see.
Do you want to try to get the audio working?
Yeah, let's see. I think it has to do with, yeah, let's try that. Cool, because usually it plays from, yeah, from this, but let's see if it works. Oh, it's because the volume wasn't turned up. Yeah. That's it. Probably getting feedback from the mic. We don't usually have a setup like this when you're recording, but it's cool. So once you record, we give users up to 3 minutes to record a track. And when you're finished, you now have the option to either submit it publicly or privately. A public submission is so other people in the community can listen to the tracks, give you feedback. One of the cool features that we have is a producer would have a live feed of all the tracks being recorded on his beats. So as a producer, if you upload a beat, you check your profile a week later, now you have 2,000 tracks recorded on your beat that you can sort of listen to, hear what people's ideas are. And also it just creates leads for collaboration and kind of taking it to the next step in the process, which is probably selling that beat to the artist and creating a song in the context of the studio. So the phrasing I like to use is this can sort of be the first step to creation. It's that first part of the process where you know you want to make a song or you have some ideas, you lay them down. You're not confined to the studio or you don't have to have the resources. You pull out your phone, you start creating original music content, and it's in a space where other musicians and producers can hear it as well. So it's going to kind of take you down that road of either taking the song more seriously or just getting more comfortable with your voice and creation. And then the profile is pretty simple. This is my profile. So when I post to my profile, all my followers get a notification. Think like popular platforms like Instagram. We sort of based the feature set on that as far as how to interact with other users and the way that the app looks. As far as how we're doing so far, all the founders work on the product part-time. We launched in March of this year at South By, so we've been out for about 9 months without any marketing budget and actually without any energy in marketing at all. We're approaching about 50,000 users, have pretty good engagement from our user base, and are trying to figure out a few last things with products before we really invest in rolling it out, putting it in front of more people, and going to market with it fully. But yeah, that's OffTop. And actually, real quick, just so you all can hear, let me play a track so you can hear like the quality of a recording from somebody who's doing this from home.
I met him at the bar, and he was looking like a star. He even tried to play his cards. Oh, no, no, no. He went into the restroom, but he forgot his phone.
So yeah, we're pretty excited. That's cool that was recorded on a phone. And as far as references go and discovering new talent, that's more than enough to sort of determine whether or not you'd want to work with that person, you know, based on their voice and the melodies that they come up with. So we are trying to improve the actual mobile recording process, and that's where a lot of our energy goes. And it's limited by hardware, obviously, but there's still a lot of cool improvements we can make as far as capturing people's voices go. So, yeah. And any questions, of course. Yeah.
iOS and Android. The other one is cover songs.
Like covering other people's songs.
Songs that have been released as a CD or a vinyl before.
Okay, so first question is yes, we're on both Android and iOS. And as far as the second question goes, there are other products in that space that are doing that pretty well as far as like covering popular songs from a karaoke perspective. I know everybody here probably knows Musical.ly. They kind of are killing it with like the casual fan who also wants to be a musician. So we thought that if we focused on original music creation, it would sort of hone in on that person that maybe isn't Jay-Z, but isn't like the girl who wants to cover songs and somewhere in between as far as getting involved with music and starting to make music in that sense. What's up, man?
How about the legal implications of this gets really big and there are people like using things from other people and like whether you have a part in that or not?
Yeah, so we do think about that a lot, and it can get tricky because you have a producer involved, you have like a songwriter involved. If producers are uploading beats that they don't own, we'll take them down by request. We've gotten requests like that before, and we're very good about being on top of it. So I think the idea is like similar to a platform like YouTube, where it's like we're responsible for presenting and publishing the content. But if there's any ownership issues, or you know, if it's between an artist and a producer, and they own both the rights, that we're probably going to leave that to them. Like if an artist steals a producer's beat, which you can't really do on the app anyways, you can't rip a beat, that's something we focused a lot on, then I don't know if that falls under our jurisdiction. But to be honest, we're still learning a lot about like the legality. What's cool is a lot of original content is being created on the app. I think we have like 55,000 tracks created in our first 9 months. And that's definitely a responsibility as far as figuring out who owns, you know, the final version of the track. But we're pretty good at responding to requests if people reach out. Yeah, what's up?
Is who are the competitors in the market? And my second question is, how do you plan on monetizing this?
Yeah, well, you guys are definitely a competitor, RecordGram. I've done my research, the legendary Mims. This is why I'm hot. So I'm familiar with you guys. It's a big space. This is a big space. A lot of people want to sort of be the app that, you know, users are capturing audio on from mobile. We know about RapChat, which was the first one to sort of take off. There's one called Brap, which is a video app that you can record. Man, there's like 15 of them. There's really a lot of them. And it's interesting because we think a lot about product differentiation and what the recipe is going to be to get it right. And it's difficult because musicians create in so many different ways. And like all of you could have a relationship with music, but it could be very different for each one of you as far as like I create once a month or I create every week or I'm like a music technology purist and I would never record on a phone, you know. So there's all these sort of considerations that we're trying to capture, and we're stuck at this crossroad between are we a utility or are we like a social discovery platform. We have both happening. People use us as a utility and don't care about the social side, and then other producers hit us up and want to pay us for their beats to be featured on the app, you know, and get discovered and then help artists get discovered based on their freestyles. So we're spending a lot of time to figure out where we want to go holistically and who our core user is as far as that dilemma. As far as monetization, like I'm sure you guys know, beat sales is the most obvious one. As far as like producers finding new people to sell their beats to, that market could use some disruption, but at the same time, like not sure if it's the biggest market in the world. We're still trying to figure out there where the opportunity is. We've had opportunities to sponsor our beat categories. So people will say like, hey, I run a website. Could we get on your homepage and then like curate some beats? So like people will, you know, they'll get exposure to like whatever that website is if it's a group of producers. So some sort of interactive advertising that we can do that is kind of ingrained with the product and not annoying to the user. And then maybe like contests is another area, some pay-to-play stuff where there's a reward like working with an artist. And if you pay $1, you enter the contest and the top five submissions, you know, get to meet this artist and record in a studio. There's a lot of ways to engage the users on that front. We presented in schools, we've done like creative workshops, and they really loved the app as far as letting the students use it to help them like keep track of their vocal notes. That's a potential path for us, but as you could tell, we're sort of still figuring out. We've done all these different things and are trying to gauge where all of our energy and resources are going to go as far as monetization. Yeah, what's up, man?
Are you guys geared solely toward beats, or do you anybody who got a song that they just wrote looking for a singer or a bass player, or is it just solely beats?
Currently, we try to keep the interaction simplified to instrumental vocal. As far as like the extent of the collaboration goes on the app, like the actual recording of your voice over the beat. As far as like allowing multiple people to collaborate on the platform with like, let's say, playing a guitar or sharing like a vocal sample, we've explored doing it in reverse, where maybe you just record the acapella and then the producer hears your voice and wants to sell you the beat. And there's definitely some interest there, so that's a route we may go. But we're definitely going to stay away from like the band lab territory, which is like trying to emulate a DAW on your phone and like let anybody collaborate and make songs. Like personally, I don't know if I see the future in that, because that music creation process is so dense, it's very hard to emulate on a mobile device. And that's why we're trying to keep it simple with just all you need is a voice and a beat. That'll kind of create the interaction that you need to take it further into the studio if you want to actually record a song. And people will post these songs on their SoundCloud or Twitter and like release them to their fans. So we're exploring opportunities to get bigger artists on the platform to drop a verse, maybe a cool way to engage with their fans more frequently, or have a unique platform beyond Instagram and Twitter to get the fans excited and create highly shareable content in that sense. Yeah.
Is this going to become open to all users, or are you still going to always be monitor like who's posting the meets and who's joining the app?
Yeah, so the next, we're working on a pretty big update that's going to address that, and we're going to just let people upload directly to the app. I think that we're still going to do a lot of quality control as far as what ends up on our homepage, but we do want to allow producers to be on the app if they want to. And it's impossible to listen to even 50 beats a week without wanting to, you know, never hear a beat again. So we don't want to do that part of the job anymore.
Yeah, you mentioned social, which kind of answered my question, but how did you get from 0 to 50,000 users in that month?
So that video was a big help. We had a friend who worked at Facebook, and they get ad credits. So he hooked us up with ad credits for a few months, and we just ran that video. And it really took off. It got, I think we were like, it was like 10 cents a download was our cost of user acquisition. So that's really the only marketing we've done. The rest is probably word of mouth. Now we're looking at opportunities to go to press and have some bigger collaborations. I think it's interesting too, because in this space that's potentially consumer facing, and we were looking for the backing of maybe an artist, or that's one of the things that we're spending time on, is finding somebody who can champion the product for us and really show the value to the fans that look up to them. So that's an interesting thing as well with MusicTech, because it's a whole different space. The conversations are very different when you're talking to artists and what they're looking for as far as partnerships go. Our team is one, two, three, four people. Yeah, four people. Yeah. None of us get paid, so it's all just equity for the developers. And we've tried to get as close to an MVP as we can before we raise a round, because we want to focus a lot of that energy on going to market.
So you haven't got investors yet? No. This all sweat capital?
Yeah, this is all. We've just done this for free. Yeah. Thank you, man. Thank you. It's stressful, but. I actually just left my real-time job to focus a little bit more on getting us some funding, so we're going out there, yeah.
One more question.
Yeah.
Just curious, how does the copyright work on the finished product?
So currently in the terms, anything that's recorded on the app, we own the rights to. That makes it seem like we're going to sell the content, or like we're going to do something with the people don't approve of. But that was the way that it had to be written, as far as like the simplest, because the producer or the user wouldn't own the rights if they're recording over the producer's beats. Specifically, like as far as if the user wanted to sell the track or like commercialize the track, the way that goes naturally is you have to ask the producer for rights to the beats. You can't release tracks and commercialize them if the producer didn't sell you the beat. So we assume that that interaction is happening between the users and encourage it. As far as like down the road, if we're gonna do anything with the content, we like re-release mixtapes on SoundCloud, which is cool because our users love getting kind of exposed to our user base. But another big thing to consider is that this is all recorded on a phone, and as confident as I am in my product, I don't think people are close to paying for music content that's been recorded on a phone yet. We're realistic. Like there might be an opportunity to monetize in other ways, but we don't plan on selling the content directly, at least not yet. So that answers your question. But yeah, in the terms of service, we own everything that's recorded on the app. Cool. Thank you, guys.
Great job. Awesome. I love how everyone applauded when you said you quit your job. You know, that's like, that's what this meetup's really all about, is supporting the entrepreneurs and getting valuable feedback. And so thank you, everyone. Let's see. Let's hang out, network. Darren's going to play some more songs. I want to give you guys, does anyone have any announcements they want to make? Please. VR in the corner. A couple announcements. Come on up if you just want to say something to the group real quick. Otherwise, you know, I think there's still hopefully some food and drinks, and we'll hang till 9. And then there's a bar called Licorette that we went to after the last meetup. If you guys want to hang out or do like an after party over there, that'll be fun.
Thanks very much. Hi, everyone. I'm James. I'm a cellist and a pianist, and I dabble in other instruments I'm not so good at. I'm actually from Scotland, and I work in London, and I'm visiting America this week, and I was in San Francisco last week. And I'm the founder of a company called Encore, ENCORE if you can't understand my accent. We are half marketplace for musicians and half LinkedIn for musicians. So if anyone's heard of a market network, that's kind of what we're trying to do. We're trying to give musicians somewhere to show off their reputation and show off how good they are, but also to kind of generate new bookings and generate new contacts and generally take their careers further. We're not live in the US and we don't plan to be for a while. We have 1 in 4 musicians in the UK using us, so around 21,000 musicians in the UK using us. And basically, if anyone is a musician and is a band leader or does weddings or functions or those kind of private events, I would just love to speak to you and just kind of get more of an understanding of how music works in New York or America, because I know from the last 2 weeks it's very different from the UK. So yeah, that's me. Thanks for listening.
Anyone else want to?
Hey everybody. So this is my name is Phil. This is Michael. We run an app called Radiate. Basically, creates social networks around music festivals. This is our first meetup, so just want to say hi to everybody and looking forward to meet everybody and introduce ourselves to the whole. So that's about it.
And we have the winner of the drawing for Rock, Paper, Scissors, PR.
Okay, here, mix them up a little bit. Like that.
And the winner is MJ Filson from Artisan's Label. Yeah. Yeah. Dimitri, thanks so much for coming down here and sponsoring, and hope you'll come back again. Okay, cool. And also, I just wanted to thank all of the volunteers, Rekha and Pam and Carlos, thank you. And who else did I forget? Chris and, yeah. We've got a great community here. So, you know, this is kind of a grassroots meetup kind of thing. If you ever have any ideas for other events you want to do, don't hesitate to reach out, and we'll try to make it work. And so, thank you. Yeah. Thank you.